I'll be keeping them anyway. You can probably get a 30, so I ain't worried about, you know, trying to get there in less than 8, because we ain't gonna wake up an hour, I don't think.
Evening, Wes. How's it going, Jake? Sorry, starting a little later than what I said we were going to. We were inside eating. NASCAR trucking stream is sponsored by Coca-Cola. They're Ruffles. With associated sponsor Nabisco. Time's the right time, that's for sure. That's when I ain't gotta pull all my hair out because everybody's trying to crash us. Or I got a guy blowing his friggin' tire all over my hood and trailer and friggin' windshield. I got a big old thing on my windshield from that huge piece of rubber that flew. Thanks to Patrick for screenshotting that and sending it to me. And on my trailer, the door, there's a big old chunk, about that big, of the wrap that got ripped off the trailer. The one on the hood, I think, can be wiped off, but the wrap is tore on the trailer. Hey, babe. Yeah, it's probably about that big, the area where the wrap is tore off on the door of the trailer side door mat. Probably about that big. Got my text message, right, babe? You didn't answer it, so I figured maybe you got it. I don't know. Rolling. Yep, I saw that. Michael Jordan and Denny Hamlin. Unknown, supposedly car number is going to be 23. Yeah. No, 1U. I had my window down when I went by it. I smelled it a lot.
The other thing, too, is, you know, a lot of times when you're in a position like Ford, the sponsors like you because they're used to it. The sponsors don't look like it. Right, you bring the money to the programs and they keep you. But at some point, you fall off enough to be like the, you know.
This guy's probably pretty pissed off behind me because I'm going so slow, but I dumped my axle and I didn't want to shift anything.
At the traffic light. Traffic light.
So chat's not on the screen, just to let you know. Please hang out. Enjoy this last stage. I understand y'all gotta go to bed and stuff like that. Get you sleep.
Continue on I-40.
I'll check in periodically with y'all.
Let me ask you this. Who's
before I kick it to 80 again.
Kevin Harvick and Kyle Busch, and of course, you know, they finish one, two. So they went those two, and then you had Clint Boyer, which I really struggled on putting in my top five. I did not. You did. And you finished sixth. So I think you win with the tiebreaker being who got the next one closest to the top five. So you edge it out and take the titles.
Now, who did you have instead of Clint Boyer? Did you have Joey or somebody? Is there?
Yeah, I had Joey Lutnitz, who missed just outside the top 10.
You know, Kyle says nobody likes Joey. Joey doesn't have any friends.
I think Brad's his friend on some days.
Yes, some days, yes. So, before we talk about Las Vegas, any thoughts on the new Ross Chastain going to the 42 or the new Danny Hamlin?
You're behind it. I'm dropping speed right now, but I'm not dropping the ball.
very lucky that
better than what,
you know, it's just funny how we're really taking off like I love that
bird kill. Yeah, Burstall killed me too.
2017, 2018, something like that. Burstall, and here he is, he comes and wins the race. We both predict to Kyle Busch.
Here's that freaking Honda again.
So now we go to Las Vegas, and it does make sense. We are seeing, there's a reason, you know, that certain drivers are bubbling to the top. They're in that zone, and so it's hard to get off of those characters. And so with that said, my number five driver to watch is a guy that you like, and he's just getting better out here, Kevin Harvick. 22 starts in the desert, 2 wins, 7 top fives, 32%. Numbers are good. 3 of those top fives looked at game in his last 5 starts. One of them was a win in 2018. He's number 2 hottest for me over the last 6 races. He's rated number 4 for me in tracks like this. So, yeah, I agree with you. Kevin Harvick, solid luck to put in your top 5. Number 4 driver, he can sleep at home on Saturday night. Number 18, Kyle Busch. You like him to win? Hey, not so sure, but definitely think he has to be in your top 5. Since number 10 in points, 6th hottest over the last 6 races.
They will not budge from that left lane, will they?
7 top 5s,
30%. No,
you
fucking
went
and checked up right there in front of me. And killed all my momentum.
Number 3 driver is
here. I can think
back
on this.
I wonder how
that
man was
broke. Yeah, after I ended up clearing him and everything like that, I moved over and it was like almost like I cut him off because they drove right up my ass.
Again, in the race last year, his 2 wins came in his last 6 races. In fact, 4 of the 6 races.
I guess there's dumbass out here still.
My number 2 pick is another guy that you like too, and it's the most recent winner. Number 22, Joey Logano. Joey's 6 top 5s in his 14 starts. He's got the win here in March and the March before. He's just getting better because his 6 top 5s came in his last 9 starts. All 9 of his last starts were all top 10s. He's number 2 hottest over the last 6 races and ranked number 3 for me on tracks like this. So then you go, who's going to win? Now, you like Chase Elliott? I couldn't figure out how to put Chase Elliott in my top 5 because I like Joey's teammate, the driver with 10 consecutive top 10s at Las Vegas. Number 2, Brad Keselowski. Brad has the number 1 highest average finisher over the last 7 years. He has wins in 2014, 2016, and a playoff race in 2018. He got those 3 wins in just 14 starts, just as impressive as 7 top 5s. That's 50% of his starts have been top 5s, and he's not in your top 5. He finished 7th or better in his last 10 starts here. Now, I'm telling you, Brad is number 6 ranked for me on the downforce tracks, and he sits number 5 hottest, not as good as the other guys over the last 6 races. But I think this is the week that Brad sneaks his way to the front.
I slowed back down again, 78, let you catch back up.
So for the nine being your second 5?
Good question. He does do really, really well. He might not make my top 10, but he'll be high up in that third group.
So I'll tell a little quick story about being the race doctor out in Las Vegas. We're out there, race doctor and his buddy had some tickets, and they were trying to tell me where the seats were. And the race doctor, and I just got a cell phone. The race doctor was texting me. And my phone keeps saying, "You have a message."
I remember that.
Such an old hillbilly, when it says you have a message, I'm checking my voicemail.
Do you really hear anything?
No voicemail. Says you have a message, no voicemail. 3 months later, I realize we're sitting in section 231, row, 14, seats, 5 and 6. I didn't get your text until 3 months later until my son showed me how to use the phone.
And if I remember, you had a flip phone.
Yes.
Yes, the old flip phone. Oh, yes.
The jitterbug prototype or something.
Well, I mean, for a guy who works out of his house, you just never had a need for it, so.
It wasn't until I was at the racetrack doing, sometimes I would be at the racetrack doing a live radio show. That's when I actually needed a cell phone. Because what if you go on to him, tell him what to do.
Yes, yes. And it's funny, too, because the whole texting thing, it's like, yeah, once you're out of track, and it's hard to get voice calls through back in the day. Now they've upgraded the cell service and all that stuff. But back in the day, it was hard just to make a voice call and get it into a track. But two, it's so loud, you can't hear the message anyway. Sure. So, yeah, it's like texting's really, you know, paid off. And raced it. And this was a long time ago. But, yeah, that's funny.
Yeah, so this was the flip phone. And this is back when you had to text by pushing the number three times. So,
yeah.
It's just that's...
I remember those days.
Yeah, that's way out of my skill set.
That's a lot of dexterity required.
Yes, that's good for teenagers. Yes, yeah, it's good for horny teenagers. Grace Doctor, thanks a lot for being our guest. We'll talk to you again next week.
Thank you, Bojo.
Yeah, sure, I've got a right hand shoulder up here.
We'll come back and take some phone calls. I'm Bojo Nixon. This is in the Fall of Destiny. Keep playing, don't turn me off.
This is MRN's Mike Bagley, and your NASCAR Cup Series race day just got that much better. The NASCAR Finish Line app is not just a chance to win $25,000. The free-to-play app provides you a brand new fan experience based on your weekly picks. With expert analysis and live in-race tracking of your picks, you'll be fully engaged week-to-week with the NASCAR Cup Series. Go to your Apple Store or Google Play and download the next greatest way to experience the NASCAR Cup Series. And did I mention you can win $25,000 for free?
Rock's greatest photos in genius playlists for the musically curious. Welcome back to the Integrity Network. Over 100 continuous critically acclaimed shows hosted by Don Tillman, including a new Never Heard Before episode. Think Time Radio on a full of whiskey movies. Toast the return of the Bob Dylan Theme Time Radio Hour, a serious XM limited engagement channel.
Get around them finally.
September the 27th on Channel 27.
Yeah,
serious XM app.
Liberty Mutual Insurance Company customizes your home insurance so you only pay for what you need. As a minimalist, paying less for insurance is more.
Nice place. Is your house a bubble?
It's a dome. I find corners unnecessary.
At Liberty Mutual, that's how we feel about overpaying for insurance.
But I do miss having shelves.
What would you put on them?
Nothing, obviously.
Only pay for what you need at libertymutual.com.
Notice for people suffering with fibromyalgia symptoms. Researchers from the University of Illinois College of Medicine have developed the first definitive blood test for the biomarkers of fibromyalgia. Those who test positive may qualify for an FDA-approved clinical trial of a breakthrough symptom-eliminating treatment. Previously, a fibromyalgia diagnosis could not be confirmed. Now, participants can have definitive confirmation of this debilitating disease. The test is covered by nearly all insurance plans, and FM Test can even arrange to have your blood test done by a licensed medical professional in the comfort and security of your own home. If you suffer from chronic fatigue, mental fogginess, or chronic pain, it may be fibromyalgia. Take this opportunity to get the first and only definitive test. If you test positive, you could be among the first to receive a breakthrough treatment formulated to eliminate all fibromyalgia
symptoms. Do not tell me that they're starting to pass you.
So go now to myfmtest.com. That's myfmtest.com. Myfmtest.com.
See those nasty green or black stains on your deck, your roof, your sidewalk? Ruining the look of everything. Make your home the best-looking home on the block with Wet and Forget, the no-scrub outdoor cleaner. Don't bother with the pressure washer. Apply Wet and Forget to any of your outdoor surfaces, and you're done. No scrubbing, no rinsing, no ass. It's bleach-free, so you can use it on any outdoor surface. Get rid of those nasty green and black stains with no effort at all. Pick up a bottle of Wet and Forget at Lowe's, Walmart, Menards, or Ace Hardware.
Wild Pride starts NASCAR's Lady in Black. It's the 16th driver, all but nothing the best of the way. Running off elimination at the greatest tracks in the show. Turning the needle to the big one. Fight for the right to duel in the desert. Everything possible, nothing guaranteed. Yes, please. The NASCAR playoffs on NBC and NBCSN.
This is Brad Keselowski on your 24/7 home for NASCAR. SiriusXM NASCAR Radio, Channel 90. Stream it on your phone and at home on SiriusXM. Connected devices and speakers.
You're moving on, Jake. So,
Formula One track down there in Austin, Texas. The Circuit Cup, the Circuit of the Americas. Let me talk to Brandon, my producer, get his thoughts, and we'll find out what he thinks about all this. Hey, Brandon. How you doing, man?
I'm great. How are you doing?
Doing good. Lovely. Busy here on Monday night.
Very busy. More busy than what I'm usually used to on a Monday night, especially at around 8:54, 8:55 p.m. Eastern, when that news broke about Michael Jordan and Denny Hamlin and their race team.
Yeah, you know, normally before I go on, I either look at J-Ski or I look at Bob Parkins' Twitter feed just to make sure that something happened that I got, and three different things happened.
Yeah, and you know, if you look at Bob Parkins' Twitter feed, there was about 60 or 70 others, depending on who you follow, that had the news as well, and everybody talking about it. It blew up, and rightfully so. Michael Jordan's a huge, huge guy to have in this sport.
So, if you think, let's assume things go well. They get a team together. Is Bubba going to be able to run in top 5, top 10, top 15?
Yeah, I definitely think so. Bubba's a guy that, when he's been in good enough equipment to win, he's won. Kyle Busch Motorsports in a truck series, won at Martinsville a couple of times. And then, you know, when he went to Xfinity Racing after the Kyle Busch Motorsports deal fell apart, or just left, he went to Roush, and they were not so funded. He didn't win a race, but he ran good there. And, you know, he did a good job at Richard Petty Motorsports, and here he is. He hasn't been in stuff that I think, you look at most of the stuff that he's been in, he hasn't been in stuff that, he can really win it. He went to the truck series in like 2017 and won a truck race even, I think, at Michigan.
Right.
So he's proven he can win at times when he's got good enough stuff. Now, the cup level with these cup drivers, completely different game. Don't know what we're going to do next year when it comes to practice and qualifying. And it may take him a half a year to really get going here, depending on who the crew chief is and what kind of team they put together. But once things get right, I think Bubba Wallace can absolutely win.
Right now, essentially, Rich Petty Motorsports is a satellite of RCR, right? So, being a satellite of Gibbs, that's a better deal.
Oh, yeah, for sure. You know, and you just got to look at within your own manufacturing. And Rick Hendrick, I think Hendrick Motorsports, you look at that, they're the number one team at Chevrolet. Gibbs is the Toyota team. So, you know, you look at that and say, Childress is number two at Chevrolet. Gibbs is the number one in the sole Toyota team. So even at that point, you're moving up in that sense as well. So.
Well, and also, right, that's why Gibbs left. They left Chevrolet because they were always going to be second.
Third in line. They were third in line behind Hendrick and RCR.
Yeah. Right, so they were right. They were always going to be tenth there. They wanted to, they wanted to be the big dog. And guess what? They are the big dog.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
And so what do you think about old Ross Chastain going to 42?
I wasn't surprised or shocked by that move, but I'm surprised it came out as early as it did. I think there were a lot of people that were pinning Eric Jones to linking him to that ride. Jones is a good driver, and I think a lot of people thought, okay, that's going to be a place where we can wind up at the 42. I think a lot of people thought Ross would do another year in Xfinity or go run for the Spire team, which was the rumor, and then go to Ganassi once Kurt Busch decided he didn't want to do it anymore. But I think Chip saw the opportunity. Maybe there was an opportunity for Ross somewhere else, and Chip thought, okay, if I want to keep Ross Chastain in this organization, I need to bring him cup racing, and he's going to do it next year in the 42.
And speaking of the 42, girl, what about the old driver there? What do you think is going to happen there?
It was reported differently several different times.
And that guy who we called earlier was
RCR guys, because they're like Richard Petty Motorsports, where they're very closely aligned with RCR. They're right there in the campus in Welcome. So the Germain team is currently. So I don't know how many of those guys are RCR guys. The cars are show relays. If the Jordan team is going to run Toyotas, and I would imagine if they will, since Danny Hamlin's involved, you know, you look at that and say they can't use any of the race cars either. So all of that probably goes back to RCR. What happens to crew chief Matt Borland? I don't know. But I think it's just they're getting the charter and they're going to move on from there.
So if NASCAR is going to run the All-Star Race, an exhibition down in Texas, which means, you know, they don't have to, you know, play by all the rules, maybe Eddie Gossage is going to make a ramp and you have to jump over a boat full of alligators. I mean, it's an exhibition, right? You're supposed to put on
that, that
show.
Hyundai that's behind
maybe
me.
Maybe there'll be a fiery hoop that you can shoot
not
through.
I'll tell you, if they could do it, Eddie Gossage would do it. I think that's an exciting part about the All-Star Race going to Texas, but I think the thing that's underrated is, you know, we kept it at Bristol. No matter what happens, I know where Texas is losing a date, it's going to Dakota, or importantly. You still, majority of racetracks are still 1.5-mile racetracks. If you want to make the racing better or try something, you can do that like we were doing in Charlotte. You can do that at the Texas Motor Speedway, which is 1.5-mile over. So, to me, I look at that and say that's a good thing if we're going to try something in, you know, on the aero package at a 1.5-mile racetrack. We can do it in competition in the All-Star Race.
Yeah, and I'm sure, right, that if we do have the All-Star Race here, they'll put on a show. And it'll be a festive air at the race.
Yes, for sure. And it's in a different market. It's been bounced around from Bristol this year because of COVID. It's going to be exciting and interesting to see it in a new track again this year.
So we don't know what's going to happen next year. We don't know how long this COVID thing is going to last. Do you think that we'll have practice qualifying next year come February? Do you think we'll have fans in the stands, or will it take?
Farm Aid. 35 years later, lot to take in. Let's put it that way. Saturday gave us a lot of information to absorb. And then Monday, before we even get a chance to really react to it, one of the bigger, probably, what, top three questions in silly season was answered. So, where do you want to start here?
Well, let's make sure that those who may be just joining us here at the top of the hour are, as they say, up to speed. The big announcement today from Chip Ganassi Racing, Ross Chastain will drive the number 42 Cup Series Chevrolet for that organization next year. Great opportunity for Ross, one that he has, A, worked very hard to get, and B, been very patient in awaiting. A great opportunity for that young man, for the Mellon man, to get his crack in a full-time Cup Series ride with a very competitive racer.
Yeah, I'll be honest. If that were the only ride open this season, it would have been my first thought was, okay, Ross has been with Chip Ganassi Racing for years. They have kind of a, you know, their past hasn't been the perfect, you know, just fairy tale, but not to any fault of either of them, the sponsorship, you know, chip issues and things like that. But with the off-season that we, or not off-season, the silly season that we've had and the drivers that are available, it wasn't something that I was going to be able to predict, right? Like, it makes sense looking at it now, but with guys like Eric Jones in the fold and Corey LaJoie out there and Bubba Wallace, I still don't know where he's going, it wasn't something that I had at the top of my mind of, okay, Ross Chastain in the 42. Like you said, he's put in his time. He certainly worked hard for it. He hasn't had the success at Cullet Racing this year that I think he would really like to see it have.
He's been the king of the bridesmaids.
Right, I mean,
how many second place finishes does Ross Chastain?
That's what I mean. I mean, he's been strong. It's one of those deals where, I don't know, for a cup ride, sometimes I did nothing against Ross Chastain. I like the guy. I'm just looking at guys like Eric Jones that are out there in the field. And we don't know, obviously, what those guys have going, what they have planned, who they've been talking to. I don't know any of that. But, and I'm not down on this hire whatsoever. It was just a little surprising to me to look at a guy like Chastain who, I don't know, I felt like could use one more year in the Xfinity Series. I feel like you really need to win consistently there before you move up to the next step. But, I mean, from Chip Ganassi Racing's perspective, you know, you owe this guy.
Here's something for y'all. What do y'all think about this scenario? If y'all are listening. Alright? Make sure y'all are sitting down when I say this. What do y'all think about this? Chase Briscoe to 32. Go Fast Racing. Chevrolet. Or, sorry, not Chevrolet. Ford Mustang. Becomes a full sponsored and funded satellite team for SHR. Corey LaJoie goes to the 98 in the Xfinity Series. Yes, he's going down a series, but he's going into a very competitive championship ride. What do y'all think about that? Goes to 32 and Go Fast becomes a fully funded actual satellite team for Stuart Haas Racing. Corey LaJoie goes down a series, but ends up in a championship ride in the 98 over at Stuart Haas.
Down to three.
Down.
I wonder what happened.
a break and the crowd's still going wild, then all of a sudden you hear me quiet real quick. It's like, guys, just let us watch the game.
Easy on the slider there.
Yeah, like, yeah. I don't even care. Just, like, just don't even put the crowd noise in. I mean, I know it's a different world for us because the car's going to drown out most of it, but there's no question that you could hear the crowd and feel the energy that it
brings. But, yeah, post y'all's opinion about what I just said on there. I'll read it here later. When I glance at it periodically, I'm not going to stare at it while driving down the road, like I've said. So
that's one thing to say about the car character of Kevin Harvick. But to see him, like, you
I'll
could
say it again, Chase Briscoe was, to 32.
To
Go Fast becomes a funded, actual, full satellite team for Stuart Haas Racing. And Corey LaJoie goes down a series, but ends up in a championship ride in the
98.
Just mow that over a little bit, guys.
To get out of the car and still be moved by the fact that there are 30,000 fans there, it shows how much it means to this sport and these drivers.
Yeah, it might be signal. We're out west, so signal's going to be spotty. I mean, just be forewarned, I'm probably going to have to restart the stream several times and stuff like that.
I've been watching the NHL playoffs, and they're doing it the other way. They're not doing a lot of the crowd, like the crowd noise thing. So, you know, here come the Penguins down the ice, slap shot, score. And all you hear is some guy going, "Way to go, Pierre, nice shot." And that's it. See, all you get is the players going, "Woo, that's the right, buddy," and that's all you get.
I love that. It's like watching episodes of Hard Knocks, because even yesterday, like when I was watching the game, every once in a while they pull the crowd noise down a little bit, and you hear the players interacting with each other, for better or worse. It's not always a family program when you do that. But I don't know, there was something about, like, there was a play where Steelers were on offense, it was a fourth down, they were just trying to draw Denver off sides. And they're doing the hard count, and all of a sudden you hear the defense go, he moved, and I was like, alright, I kind of like this. I like that you can actually hear them, like, trying to call each other out.
Like, you're hearing things you're not supposed to hear.
Yeah, it's exactly, I felt a little dirty, like I was listening to a conversation I wasn't supposed to.
When the quarterback calls an audible using the head coach's wife's name.
Yeah.
Sydney Root! Wait a minute.
There were a couple audible calls yesterday that caught my attention. They were like, I think the Steelers had one that was like Pringles and then a day. I don't remember.
It just used to be Omaha.
Yeah, it was just Omaha, over and over.
Omaha. No.
But no, I don't know. I'm anti-Crowd Boys. I am pro 30,000 at a minimum people with bursting.
I'm pro Crowd Noise. I'm anti-recorded Crowd Noise.
That's true. I really want to ask somebody that's doing that if they, like, did they pull that from an actual game at some point, or was it just like stock crowd noise that they got off like Adobe and stuff?
Like a CD.
That's what I was really curious where that came from.
Crowd Noise 9, Bill!
You know somebody's sitting up there with a board, just one button that says booze, one's like big roar, little roar.
Yeah. Apathy, you know, whatever.
Okay. Yeah, the occasional clap in silence if someone gets hurt, like that's all it is.
All right, coming up on the program today, about 15 minutes from now, Jeff Block from The Athletic is going to join us to break down another big night for Kevin Harvick and company at Bristol Motor Speedway. Jeff Block coming up at the bottom of the hour, top of the hour, if that's not good enough, Rodney Childers will break down another big night for Kevin Harvick and Stuart Haas Racing at Bristol. We'll talk to Rodney Childers about all that.
He is now going all right back there.
4:30 Eastern time. Greg Ives swings by for our weekly get together. A 16th place finish for Alex Bowman at Bristol. Right. That was not at all what they had in mind, but it was enough. Greg Ives joins us coming up in our next hour. That in your calls at 866-748-5263, Sirius XM Speedway on your Monday. Dave Moody, Dan Mazzella here on your home for NASCAR, Sirius XM NASCAR Radio. Jeff Pioneer.
It's a 400-mile thrill ride of the 76 on the low side.
4, 3, 2, 1, 3, 3.
In a sport where numbers matter, some are more important than others. We're reducing emissions by 43% with Sunoco Green E15 biofuel.
What I understand is Boyer is going to run another year in the 14.
See how you can help NASCAR reduce its numbers on the environment by visiting NASCAR.com/green today.
College football is back. Every week you'll hear all the biggest games on Sirius XM.
Launching a dual shuttle pass inside the ETA and touchdown.
ESPNU Radio Channel 84's legit lineup of analysts, including Danny Cannell, Greg McElroy, Rick Neuheisen, and Rob Hewlett, get you ready for game day.
I think the Big attendance the opportunity to be the biggest winner in college football.
Get the game times and channel numbers for all the live games at SiriusXM.com/collegefootballschedule.
What 360 gives you that nobody else gives you is the perks.
You can just imagine how much fuel with your sleep.
Quarter than 118 cents off a gun.
Picking the load to go to the place to get the discount on not only the fuel, but the tires and the maintenance. While listening to the discount that I got on the satellite radio, this is all wraps in one.
With J.B. Hunt, you get paid in 48 hours at no charge. That changes the game.
Set up your free account today at jbhunt.com/perks.
My name is Eddie Williams. I've been driving for about 4 years. One of the great things about Takedown 360 is access to anywhere, anytime, to see freight from any part of the United States. I like the ability to still negotiate rates while picking freight, not only for today, but for the future. You can't beat that. The app is amazing. It's easy. It's a great tool to have. JB Hunt 360 is leading the way.
Set up your account today at jbhunt.com/carrier360.
If you're a business owner with salespeople, how in the world could you say no to this offer? The top 20% of your salespeople close 80% of the business. 80% of all sales are closed after the fifth attempt. And 83% of all salespeople don't even ask for the sale once. Did you know that 90% of all salespeople have never even read one sales book? How many sales are being lost each month simply because your salespeople are not professionally trained how to sell? Hi, this is the world's top sales trainer, Jason Evans. I'm going to give you a free 45-minute video of pure sales training techniques that will increase your company's sales within days guaranteed. This can double, even triple your company's sales. This video is closing, handling objections, and more. Just call us and leave us a voicemail or email address, and we'll send you this amazing video for free. Call 800-500-8320. This is how to close A to Z for any product or service, regardless of industry, whether you sell face-to-face or over the phone. Call 800-500-8320. That's 800-500-8320. Pay for it.
I also wanted to give a little comment on Ross Chastain. I think, I don't
Kenta took that ride, everybody was saying, well, why are you not putting rods in the ride? And Chip was like, don't worry, we got plans for Ross. He's not going anywhere. And, you know, I went to tickets provided by XM Series Radio last year at Gateway, and he won that truck race. And you and Dan talked about it. This guy has had, you know, highs to highs, lows to lows. I think because he decided that instead of running the full-time Xfinity last year and build trucks, and he came out and obviously he got, you know, he won a race even before he decided to take go back to the truck. Then he won, then he got DQ'd, and then he came back to Gateway to win that race. And I got to go to victory lane, I got to see him celebrate, and he's, I think you nailed it right in the head, that Ricky Rudd, maybe even like an old school, like Marty Herman, is probably the best way to describe Ross Chastain.
All right, Scott, thank you. It's good to hear from you. I agree with the assessment that there were parts of that race last night that were not spelled on, or Saturday, that were not spelled on. But there's a really good reason for that. The vast majority of the drama coming into Saturday night's race circulated around 10 to 4 guys that are below the cut line fight their way up and get above the cut line. Who's going to make it and who's not going to make it? And quite honestly, the drivers who were in jeopardy coming into the race did not respond. That they did not have even approaching the kind of nights that they need to have. Ryan Blaney was finished 13th. He was tight all night long. Had a very brief run where they got the handling right, but they didn't last. Cole Custer had front-end damage early, finished 23rd. Mac DiBenedetto, I mean, he was fun to watch at times. Lost 3 laps. Rebounded, got them all back, rode around in the lucky dog position for about a month. Didn't get the caution he needed. Finished up 29th after cutting a tire late. And William Byron caught up in a wreck near the end of stage 2, finished 38. There's not a lot of drama in that, my friends. When the people that need to run spectacularly well to try and pull a rabbit out of the hat finish 13th, 23rd, 29th, and 38th, there goes your drama. The people that were in did what they had to take advantage of the people that were out who did absolutely nothing to help themselves. And as a result, not a lot of them.
The most unique regular season in baseball is
automatic base runner and second doubleheader will get scheduled to be 7.
It comes down to this.
Let's take the lead. Way, way out of here.
Make MLB Network Radio.
Can you believe it?
And all of the drama of the spring to the postseason.
We all journey together into
guys are getting in your way. You can understand the frustration there. Now, obviously, if things worked out just slightly different, I'm talking to you, on the phone call about how, well, Kyle finally won his first race of the year, and we're going to be sitting there saying, hey, he won at the right time, and now is he a contender for the Final Four and all this stuff, you know? It's funny how one thing can change the whole narrative and the whole feeling of it. And that's not just the media thing. I mean, that's with the team and everybody, right? So, I understand the frustration that night, but I think he's still going to be okay, honestly, despite him saying he'll be eliminated next round.
So that prediction that they won't survive the round of 12, that's, to your mind, that's just heat of the moment disappointment and not a lack of confidence that could determine, that could become like some sort of self-fulfilling prophecy?
Well, I think it is a lack of confidence for sure, but, at the same time, he's saying after it, oh, well, where do I stack up? Where am I at points right now? And then playoff points, going into the next round, he's 10th. So he's like, well, that's where we are. We're 10th compared to those 7. But in reality, he actually finished round 1 fifth of points, I believe. And he was almost as close to the points lead with Harvick, despite not having any playoff points and Harvick winning 2 races, as Kyle was to the cutoff line. I think he was 63 points in the good from the cutoff line. And
I slowed down a little bit to let him drag you in more.
So even though he's certainly not running up to his standards, and he had one race this year, and he probably doesn't feel too good about it, ultimately, he did pretty decent in the first round. So, I don't know if they're that far off, and I think that they certainly have enough to make it to round 3. Now, whether he makes it beyond that, I don't feel too good about that, and I can understand that.
Wouldn't it be 10, 32, 14, 4, 98?
McCord Rogers that came in below the cup line, and are now out. Were you a little bit surprised that there wasn't a stronger effort on any of their parts, really, to fight their way back in, and there wasn't a lot there, but after a lot of build-up and time?
Yeah, you're right.
I guess you're in a trucker talking mood tonight.
And Byron not wrecked out. I think it was a battle between Boyer and Byron. Might have come down to a couple points. Boyer ends up getting a 6-place finish, so he was kind of making it in the end, regardless of Byron crashing. We don't know that.
Tell Junior he needs to get over to my house, man. I got that new grill. I want to start grilling out some shit. He needs to come over. He said he was going to come over for barbecue, but things popped up. He needs to come on over after this bullshit's done. I'm talking about the season.
Don't know how long ago while you grill up. You see, at first it's all shit stains. Grilled shit probably stinks worse.
Sometimes you think, okay, well, that guy had a bad night, but he'll be okay. Because I probably just think about Denny earlier.
Hey, no matter how long Stone Cougar it's been grilled.
Race there, which is one of the best races I've seen in a while, and that it wasn't a good race pole that I
talk to me no more.
Action that you normally see at the Bristol night race and stuff, like, oh my gosh, what's gonna happen? It's gonna be absolutely insanely crazy. And it was good. You mentioned like the battle at the end last 60 laps or was outstanding, but as far as the typical Bristol race, I'm not sure that we saw it.
So on down to the round of 12.
Yeah, I was saying Junior's dad must be mad at me or something, because he don't even talk to me no more.
I don't know. I think I got some stuff going on.
See about buying that zero turn from Vestal. That zero turn that he was telling me about, I'm gonna see about buying that so I can do my own lawn and stuff.
Yeah,
that's
probably a good deal. Hell, I don't know. The zero turns are pretty nice almost.
Oh yeah, brand new. They're usually about $5,000 for a zero turn. Yeah, there's probably a sweet to you, but what I mean by indirect is you put whatever you're cooking on the side that's on, and the heat from the side that's on is what you actually do the cooking, which you will.
Trust me, you will. I'm going to make sure my name will be the one you remember forever.
Yeah, one thing I like about my grill too is I got that side burner, so you know I can have like a pot of like chili or something like that cooking at the same time as I'm grilling up. So you know.
5 years since I flipped the switch, channel 102, and radio and
Yeah.
Yes, Tom?
Yeah, I'm having a good ask. I think in the drive.
Yeah, okay. Well, I think everybody is. Thank you, Tom, very much. I think everybody is. You know, maybe a couple of people that run into it wrong. Maybe somebody's not, but I think most everybody is. Rick in Michigan, hello.
Hi, well, as far as the weekend goes, I was very happy because my two favorite drivers finished 1-2, but the news of the day is really, you know, stirred things up. I'm not really too surprised to hear about Ross Chastain. They were kind of talked about since probably last year before we knew he had a contract with Ganassi, at least with a Delta driver. Talking to Jeff Gordon, wow, I don't know which is more shocking, the fact that Texas is going to lose a points race to get the All-Star race, or whatever we're going to go to Coda. I mean, I knew we'd get some schedule shakeups, but wow, I didn't see Texas. I thought you'd have to kill any Dolphins to get a points race away from him.
Right, right. Well, I agree with you, Rick. And I guess to some degree, NASCAR has kind of given him a deal sweetener here by saying, We'll run the All-Star race, at least in 2021 at Texas. That certainly helps, you know, but the bottom line on all of this thing is you need to be careful when you say over my dead body, because someone may just take you up on that offer. It's, I get it, that stomping your butt and saying, oh, hell no, we're not giving up a race. When NASCAR calls on the hotline, you know, like the back phone, the blinking red phone that you keep under the kink cover, and Alfred answers it, yes, Commissioner? When NASCAR calls on the hotline and says, here's the deal, Eddie, one of your races is going to Circuit of the Americas. We can either do that, or we can do it and give you the All-Star race. Which would you prefer? Would you like to just lose a race? Or would you like to lose a race and get the All-Star race in return? Over my dead body all of a sudden becomes not quite as serviceable a statement as it was a few minutes ago. And I guarantee you, yes, Eddie Gossage, Marcus Smith will do something special with the All-Star race. They're really good at that kind of thing. I'm not entirely sure they see it as a fair trade. We'll ask, given the opportunity. We'll certainly ask. But sometimes you don't get to make your own calls at times like this. Woodrow in Georgia. Hello, Woodrow.
Hello, Moody. I enjoyed the crazy situation, though, other than what happened with William Byron.
Brian, Illinois. Hello, Brian.
Hello, Dave.
Hey, did you wipe after you went to the bathroom? Is that thing all the way back here? Right now?
Shut the fuck up.
But it was a great battle to trade them to. I mean, I was hoping for the bump and run. He couldn't get close enough.
Yeah, in order to bump and run, you got to get to his back bumper, and he just wasn't quite able to do that.
No, but the announcement of the All-Star race,
I want to be clear. That Jeff Luck, Jordan Bianchi do very good work, and they're right a heck of a lot. But that has not been confirmed as of yet. It is simply reported and not confirmed.
All right, well, just to give my 2 cents on it, I would not be a fan of it. I mean, take it from Charlotte and give it to Texas, basically a sister tribe. I like the idea, keep it close to Charlotte, you know, Bristol, Martinsville, you know, short track has potential to be a lot more entertaining, but that's just my opinion.
If that's what had to happen in order to bring the NASCAR Cup Series to Circuit of the America, would that be a fair trade in your view or no?
I cannot give an honest opinion about that because I've never seen that track, so I don't know.
It is, okay, thank you, Brian. It is mind-blowingly impressive. You take all the opulence and money is no object attitude that goes with Formula One, and that's what went into the building of that course, Circuit of the Americas. If you could do it right for $100, they spent $500 just to make sure. It is a spectacular venue. I believe it will be very well suited for stock cars. It was not one of those venues that was built specifically for ultra high downforce open wheel Formula One type cars. I think NASCAR will be able to go there. Unlike, you know, my concerns about some street course races of the like where they're decidedly narrow, filled with 90 degree turns and completely flat, that I don't think would lend themselves very well to a NASCAR stock car type of race. I think Circuit of the Americas could be very, very much serviceable as far as NASCAR is concerned. I think we could have extremely good races there. If in fact this turns out to be true, which knowing Mr.
for the inaugural. I got to see Jeff Burton get his first win. Junior get his first cup win and his first nationwide win. I'm an hour away from Kona. I think Jimmy Johnson might come back for that one.
That's a good point. He might. He just might for that. Yeah.
Okay. Well, of course, something new. It is awesome.
So you're a little okay with this then, huh?
Oh, yeah. Oh, definitely. Kona's only 10 minutes from the Austin airport, so they fly in and it's right there.
Well, all right, there we go. So I was gonna give you a, if you had your choice between going to a race in Texas and going to a race in Kona, which would you pick? It's not a fair question because he's been to Texas a bunch of times and he's excited about going to Kona, which I understand. Go to the hot line and talk to the victorious crew chief of the number 4 Busch Beer 4 for Stuart Haas Racing. Rodney Childers joins us. What's up, Hot Rod? Congratulations. Nicely done.
Yeah, thanks, man. It was an awesome weekend for us, for sure. And, you know, going to Bristol and having fans in the stands and, you know, the Bristol night race is just, I don't know, it's something that I've always loved. And, and you can stand there for the anthem every year, and then you just, you know, it's going to be a great race, and you know, a lot of people in those stands cheering you on, and it was just good to have all that again, and to be able to put on a great show at the end of it was something that was good for all of us. And you know, Kevin did a great job of hanging in there after he got a hole in the nose and battled it out and was able to still get us the victory lane. So it was a great night.
Winning at Bristol has always, it seems, been special to you. You've got a warm spot in your heart for that joint. Why? What makes Bristol so special?
It was just one of the places that I always, you know, went through before I went to cup racing. I was able to go there and test a few times. I was able to run the Sun Gym All-Pro car there and that race up there. And, you know, after you make laps there, especially, you know, 2 or 3 times, you really understand what it's all about and what it feels like getting in the corner, what it feels like in the transitions off the corner. And, you know, honestly, you just appreciate it. You know, it's just a... You know, it's the last great Coliseum, and after you run there, it's still that way. And, you know, I was able to go there later on and crew chief Hooters cars there. And, you know, went and actually helped Brad Peak there run a bush race one time. And, you know, that's back when there was a bunch of cars. We made the race and ran pretty good. And just somewhere that's got a lot of history for me, I guess you could say, and somewhere that I feel like I really understand. And, you know, when you understand the place, it just makes it more fun as a crew chief. You know, you feel like you can do the right thing for what the driver needs and wants, and maybe you don't feel so dumb sometimes, you know, and sometimes that makes you feel good.
Yeah, no doubt. Final 60 laps or so, from a fan's perspective, it doesn't get a lot better than that. From a crew chief's perspective, though, losing the lead to Kyle Busch, getting it back, having to race him, I mean, neck and neck over the final 50 or 60 laps, is that nerve-wracking for a crew chief, or is it as much fun for you as it is for us?
It was pretty nerve-wracking. I felt like that Kyle took off good. Kind of how it had been all night. Once he was good for about 15 laps compared to us. Then about lap 20 on tires to like lap 30, we were pretty equal. And then from 30 on, we were better. And just so happens we got to about lap 30 when we should be, you know, starting to get better than him. And we had a few laps there, and you could see it from a lifetime standpoint that we were getting better. And then we knocked a hole in the nose. And, it was automatic, you know, it's like we lost 2 tenths and we knocked a hole in the nose. So I knew after that standpoint it was going to be hard, but I also knew we had the right time to try to make up for it. And I wanted him to know what was going on. I could tell that he started fighting it. I had Timmy telling that there was a hole in the nose and that he was just going to have to
do the best he could, and from that point on, you could really tell that he stepped it up and was driving the crap out of it and did what he needed to do to get the victory lane.
Kyle was very critical of lap traffic after it was over the other night. Kevin, I don't think was other than that hole in the nose, which that kind of thing happens in Bristol, was traffic an issue for you guys on the course of the evening?
Well, I mean, honestly, when you're leading a race, you're always panicked about traffic. You're always yelling at the spotter, get us some help, and I'm always going to do that. You want all the help you can get in those situations, but, those spotters, they're doing the best job they can, and especially right now, they're all trying to stay apart up there. They're not close to each other. They can't feed on each other's shoulders and that kind of thing, most of those lap cars are doing the best job they can, and they're trying to stay out of the way, and sometimes they don't know if we would rather go on the top or go on the bottom, and then you got some of the guys that...
I hate to tell New Mexico, but I'm not wearing a mask while I'm driving,
it is what it is. It's different in every race.
They're going to get you.
We get over it and we just keep working and sometimes that comes back to you, but like I said, it just kind of is what it is at that point.
I know it obviously hasn't been a career season for Kyle Busch, at least yet, but going head-to-head with a guy that's won as many times as he's won at Bristol over the years and coming out on top, is that more of a confidence builder even than it would have been under different circumstances being somebody else?
Funny thing is they say masks required, right? But then there's companies out here that have developed a face shield so you don't have to wear a mask. So what's the point of that? It's just a face shield. It doesn't cover your mouth. All it does is cover your face. But you can still get stuff underneath, side, top, bottom. I don't get it.
Maybe had it worn.
It was designed and orchestrated by the Democrats, and I will stand behind that until the end.
I don't recall being called any of the meetings, so I can't say all the Democrats did.
About it with those guys anytime you can, no matter what racetrack it is.
Rodney Childers is with us.
They're the ones that are pushing for the masks.
For Stuart Haas racing with driver Kevin Harvick at Bristol on Saturday night.
I'm a Kyle free thinker. I think all Democrats and Republicans are crooks.
After weather kind of prevented Bristol Motor Speedway from doing everything they had planned to do with it this weekend, that there were actually what's actually appeared to be a pretty good racing group or two this weekend in the aftermath of all that. But where do you stand on the PJ1 question at this moment?
Yeah, I mean, the PJ1 thing...
I thought Tomorrow wasn't bad.
I felt like there was
a lot more things there.
No, we're not even in Arizona yet.
There's been other times
where
you have messed things up. There's certain racetracks we've gone to that it hasn't worked.
When we were in duties there before we played Dallas, I know you got to make the Democrat Republican again, but it's never going to happen.
The good race. You could run about any group, and it was about the same speed. And you saw the guys being able to move around and do certain things. And then you saw the Xfinity race that was just too much on the bottom. And when there's too much on the bottom, all it does is throw a bunch of marbles up in the second lane and the third lane. The last cars can't get out of the way. The people that are coming up on the last cars, if they try to pass them on the outside, they don't have direct. There's just a lot of different things that that go into all that. But overall, I felt like they made a great decision going into the Cup race of leaving it alone And, you know, it gave us a lot of opportunity in the race of being able to run the top and the bottom. I mean, all the way to the last 500, we could run almost the exact same speed on the bottom as we could on the top. And that's what you want. You want to be able to have options. And, like I said, they did a great job of that.
So, off we go to the round of 12, Vegas, Talladega, and the Charlotte Roval. If my numbers are right here, you are 67 points above the cut line, which is more than a full race. Man, this is the time of year that all that hard work to get those stage bonus points begins to pay off.
Yeah, for sure. I don't know that I feel confident at all or whatever from a point standpoint. I remember a couple years ago when Martin had, I think, 52 points or something like that. He was going into the playoffs. I just felt that was crazy that he had that many points. I was like, man, he's good to go. And now we got 67. And I think kind of totally different. I'm like, man, that's not enough. We just have to go out there and perform just like we've been doing.
Excuse me?
Not overreact to anything. Be smart and do the same thing that we do every week. We feel like we ran well in Vegas.
It's this nasty-ass fucking thing.
We can go out there and run well and contend for a win. Hopefully we can go out there and have a good weekend. And then the other two were a bit scary, but they're also scary for everybody. It's not just us. We have a good team, we have a good driver, and no matter if it's a road course or a super speedway or what it is, you just have to go out there and do your thing and perform. And we feel like that we can do that as good as anybody.
Do you prepare for the Roval like you do for Sonoma or for Watkins Glen, or is it different?
It's a little bit different. I think the biggest thing with the Roval is just the aerodynamics being different this year than what they were last year. That changes everything about what you're doing. It changes how you hit the curves and what the car does when it comes off the curves and where your braking points are at. All those things, and we had kind of finally zeroed in on something there last year, and we qualified well and ran top seven and ended up leading the race at the end and had a shot of winning. Hopefully we can make the right adjustments for the aero change and go back there and hopefully feel confident in what we have and make them feel good and stable and go out there and perform.
So at this point in the season, Rodney, you got 9 wins on the board. Obviously a really good opportunity to hang double digits before this is all over and done. I know you're all business. I know you're fully focused on Las Vegas because that's the next race on the schedule. But do you get any time, do you take any time to kind of smell the roses at this point and say, most people never have a year like this, much less many of them.
I feel like we're kind of in the zone right now, and we don't take the time to enjoy it. I think coming home and seeing the kids happy, seeing my wife happy, and having checkered flags in the driveway and stuff like that, those are the things that put a smile on your face. Family, when family says something to you about how proud they are of you and stuff like that, that's when it hits you that you've accomplished something. And then the other side of it is just when you start talking about win totals. And, a player asked me the other night about, being 38 wins or whatever. And for me, thinking about that and being 2 away from Mark Martin, and Mark Martin went, when I was a kid, Mark Martin was winning all the time. And I never thought in a million years that I would even get close to what Mark Martin's done in the Cup Series. And so those are the things that really make you think about, what this team has done and what we've accomplished together. But, no matter how many wins you have, it seems like everybody judges you on how many championships you have. And, yeah, we've been in that final four, what, six out of 7 years or five out of 6 years, five out of six. Yeah, we've only won it one time. And, you know, to be honest, you know, for our team, I feel like that's not acceptable. And we just have to go through these next 7 weeks and perform and get another opportunity to race forward at Phoenix and go out there and have fun and you know, do our thing.
I guess it's enough to know that if you do win the championship in Phoenix, you'll allow yourself 15, maybe 20 minutes to celebrate when it's all over.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, it's definitely a year that you know, all of us will remember for a long time. You know, I think we all said that about 2018. It's like, all right, well, we won eight races and All-Star race. You know, what kind of year is this? And, you know, then we said, oh, we'll remember it for a long time. Well, now we've had this year, and we don't really talk about 2018 anymore and what we accomplished that year. So it's all relevant to what's going on at that particular time, you know, just like, you know, Kyle and his guys, you know, they've had years where they just, you know, stomped a mud hole on all of us, and you turn around and now you see them going through some struggles like they're going through, and it makes you appreciate what we do have, and you never know when that last win may come. So, you know, we just have to soak it in best we can, but we have to stay focused and keep working on what's ahead of us.
Enjoy the stomping. Great job Saturday night, and we appreciate you stopping by. Thanks, man.
Thanks, man. I appreciate it.
All right, buddy. Rodney Childers, number 4. Bush Beer Ford for Stuart Haas Racing. Stomping them on the